Welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here. I'm Jason Camellio, and I'm the Assistant Vice President for Global Initiatives at Berklee College of Music. And I'm joined today by my co-host and co-producer, Ray Soule, who's taking care of all the technology for us and helping make this all run smoothly. We've got an awesome session for you to wrap up our remote Berklee Week at Rimon. Rimon School of Jazz and Contemporary Music is one of the founding members of our global network, and they are in Israel. It is an amazing institution. For those of you that are studying there or have graduated there or teaching there, you know this. For those of you that are looking for a place to really up your game as an artist, as a musician, and get on the pathway to becoming a student maybe at Berklee, you're really going to want to take a look at the programs that they have on offer. It is serious business. These people are exceptional educators and artists, and they're not messing around. I'll just tell you, my colleagues, Izhar Schechter, Berklee alum, and Mitchell Rosen are here. They're both leaders of the organization at Rimon. And yesterday I was doing the auditions and interviews for Berklee remotely, and we had a few of your students joining in remotely for the A&I, and they do not disappoint. They come in and the audition, honestly, it becomes like a concert, and it's beautiful, and they do a fantastic job. Even doing a Zoom audition, it was a pure joy to hear their music. So congratulations to you for all your excellent work with your students now and always. So today, this week we did sessions this week with Rimon. We did three, we're doing three great sessions. These are online. If you're part of our mailing list, I know that Ray and I will get the communications out to you. You can go back and check out the session we did on Tuesday with faculty members and alumni from Rimon and Berklee who are doing great work in the world. You can hear about the arc of their story, they're as artists, as students, and now as educators in the music industry. Yesterday we did a focused webinar on entrepreneurship, featuring both the work at Berklee and at Rimon, and had some special guests join in for that. But today we're gonna have fun in a different way. Earlier this year, I had the opportunity to travel with my colleague, who's a fantastic bassist, a highly sought after educator at Berklee, composer, band leader. And, his class that he delivers on the music of Stevie Wonder is super intriguing. And it's one of these classes that just always fills. And I think maybe you mentioned that you're trying to get another section of it in the spring just because so many students are interested in it. But Rick McLaughlin, he's been playing music all over the world. He's a band leader, sideman. He's worked with Grammy-nominated group, the Ether Orchestra, that's based here in Boston. And he's performed, in LA and Spain and in Italy and in Thailand, in Ethiopia. He's performed on dozens of records. Follow him on social media, go to his website. We'll add the links into the chat. You can check all this out. And some of the people he's worked with are Don Byron, Steve Lacy, John Medeski, Danilo Perez, and John Zorn. He's worked with rock musicians as well, like Willie Loco Alexander, with Morphine, with Peter Wolf, and country music artists such as Roger Miller. So he's, all over the map. As an artist with many talents. He's primarily, based in Boston. He's teaching in our harmony department. And he's somebody that is now going out and representing Berklee. He's been traveling with us as well, which is fantastic. His background is he studied at the New England Conservatory, where he got his bachelor's and master's degrees. And he also received an honor of the academic honors of distinction and performance there. And he's endorsed by, a few different companies like Gillian Kruger and Horner Melodicas and things like that. So this is like a serious, serious musician who's bringing some fun music to us today. Please join me in welcoming Rick McLaughlin. Thanks for being here, Rick.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. So welcome. There's so many of you. This is amazing. How many? It's three pages of faces and tiles and things. That's really awesome. Thanks for coming. There were a couple of familiar names in here too, which is kind of cool when that happens. So I'm Rick McLaughlin. I'm associate professor in the Harmony and Jazz Composition Department here. And what happened with the music of Stevie Wonder, it basically goes like this. When I first joined in the Harmony Department, I've been teaching core harmony classes the whole time. And I kind of allowed myself to let my obsession with Stevie's music kind of take over in those harmony classes. And I would go, well, for secondary dominance, I'll use this song. And for extended dominance, I'll use that song. And after a period of time, I was like, well, why don't I just pitch a course on Stevie Wonder's music? And so since about 2014, I've been teaching this class called The Music of Stevie Wonder. And in this course, we listen to about 70 songs. And the pedagogical model is student discovery. So rather than going in and me saying for 70 songs, what's cool about these things? Instead, what we do is we go in and ask the students what's cool about these things. I like that approach for a lot of reasons. I think the most important of which, from the point of view of training, is that, you know, in the professional universe, nobody tells you the answer. So to be able to begin to, in an environment that's relatively safe, to ask yourself what the answer is, to say, here's what I think the answer is, and then to, you know, work through all of those components, I think is a really crucial part of this. So I want to tell you a little bit about the course, tell you a little bit about, just kind of look through what his career, Stevie Wonder's career, has looked like, and then get to some tunes, share some tunes, and kind of work through how they work, what are some of the cool, interesting components of them. So it's weird because there's actually a former student of mine sitting right here directly in front of me right now. It's bizarre. He was in a classroom before instead of on Zoom. So hey, Dylan. Okay, and so yeah, let me just share the screen and go ahead and jump in with this. I will say that, do you guys see like a PowerPoint presentation? That's okay. So my intention with this PowerPoint presentation has never been for the PowerPoint presentation to be invigorating, because I'd rather spend my time focusing on the music. So it's going to look as exciting as it does right now. But if you have any need to reach out to me, you're welcome to rmclaughlin@berklee.edu is the address. Okay, so here we go. Let's see. How about if I go there? Okay, the course itself fits at the end, towards the end of harmony, core harmony courses. It's an elective. It's important for students to get pretty close to the end, because he does actually do some pretty slick things. So if you're already engaged in a conversation about things like constant structure or hybrid or polychord voicings, or have already got that information together, then when we actually take a look at how his music works, it'll make more sense. The department itself has all kinds of other electives. The other one that I'm involved in is the bottom one here, the Harmonic Concepts of the Music of the 1970s. That's a course that actually a committee designed, and I've taught the first section of it this term, and I'm going to do it again next term. That's a course where we do the same kind of thing for student discovery as the central pedagogical model, but it's looking at hard rock and country music and prog rock and R&B and funk and gospel music and mainstream music and jazz fusion and all kinds of different things. Also, you know, there are other courses involving, what's going on here? Other courses involving the music of the Beatles and harmonic concepts and all sorts of things. There we go. To understand Stevie Wonder's music, there are a few principles or a few kind of like aural contextual spaces that are really important to know about and to be familiar with. One is the American Standard Songbook. His music is built on that foundation, among other things. But I often am asked, well, what is the American Standard Songbook, or what's the source of information for that? And you can't just buy the American Standard Songbook. But these are my three favorite sources. So if you check out any Frank Sinatra record on Capitol, it's magic. The record In the Wee Small Hours of the Morning is, like, to me, one of the most mind-blowing records ever, because the writing is exquisite. I love Nat King Cole's piano playing, but as a singer, his recordings are amazing. And so his greatest hits, I think, is a good enough place to start. My favorite tune of his is Mona Lisa, if you guys know that piece. If you don't know the piece, check it out and pay attention to the string writing in the middle. The second phrase of the A section of the, you know, when the strings are like restating the melody, is just one of the most unbelievable things in, I'm so superlative oriented today. It's fantastic. Let's leave it there. What's his name? He'll come to me. It's not Bill May. It's the orchestrator from most of the Sinatra records. It's the same dude. And he's a genius. Nelson Riddle. Thank you. That's it. Thank you.
Hey, I got my bachelor's at Berklee, see?
Also, any Ella Fitzgerald record with the word songbook in it. A lot of times I know that, you know, there's, for many, many students, there's like a jazz barrier. And so when you say like, check out this jazz record, it doesn't necessarily result in help in the goal. The goal is to find out about this music. And these records, the songbook records, are great entries into how jazz musicians interpret this, but they're also pop records. So they're kind of easy to get your ears around. So here we go. Stevie Wonder. First of all, his quote from the 70s, just because a man lacks the use of his eyes doesn't mean he lacks vision, I think is amazing. And there's this particular scenario, this visual scenario, is not something that has really ever stopped him from living his life to the very fullest. Yesterday I was interviewing his conguero, Fausto Cuevas, and Fausto said, you know what his favorite game is? Stevie Wonder he loves air hockey, which is, you know, it's like on a pool table kind of, but there's a puck and you kind of hit the puck and he said, and Stevie Wonder will beat you every time. So there's really no space where his visual impairment is an actual handicap. I also think that in life, whatever Herbie Hancock says is the right answer. And so I can't imagine the world being the same if we hadn't been exposed to the great songs of Stevie Wonder. Those, for me, are great setups. Sometimes people need a little bit of a quantifying way of looking at things. So it's, you know, when you consider more than 100 million albums sold, a gigantic list of number one hits, he's in every Hall of Fame, he's gotten every kind of achievement award, definitely won, I think, two honorary doctorates of music. He certainly has accomplished an amazing amount of stuff. And this list, 23 studio albums, 3 soundtrack, 4 live albums, 11 compilations, a box set that contains everything. It's around 100 tracks, actually, 100 singles. It's an amazing amount of work. This first bullet may have changed recently because I know Kanye has been making a run towards this, but he's the fourth most successful singles artist behind Elvis, the Beatles, and Elton John. There's question about whether he has perfect pitch. A lot of the people who have worked with him over the years say, like, obviously he has perfect pitch. I've noticed that he has perfect pitch. I've seen him with perfect pitch. But there's also some video online where he uses a pitch pipe to confirm key centers and things like that before collaborating with people for the first time. I'm also interested in the idea that he might be synesthetic. Synesthesia is the kind of overlaying of senses. I'm not a neurologist here, but basically, you know, if you can imagine that when you hear a sound, your field of vision changes color, or when you hear when you see a color, you experience some kind of taste. I think there may be something involved with this. I'm just curious about it because, among other things, his lyrics are so incredibly vivid. And he's a central figure in Motown, which is one of the most important record labels in American music history. While he was in Detroit, he grew up in Detroit, which is where Motown is from. He was hanging out with all the jazz musicians and blues and rock and R&B and gospel musicians who were there. So he learned kind of like on the job training throughout the 1960s from some of the heaviest cats on the planet. But he also was a high school student who, while at the Michigan School for the Blind, studied classical music. So there is Rachmaninoff in his hands, and he did study counterpoint. And he went on to further those studies at USC for a minute at one point in about 1970. the list of collaborations is so long that this tiny little list is, it couldn't even, doesn't even scratch the surface. But just to think through Tears of a Clown, Ebony and Ivory, Tell Me Something Good, I Can't Help It. I mean, just that list alone is an incredible list of pieces that he's been involved in. He also is a frequent, he's frequently on commercials. Television is weirdly not as much of a thing as it once was, but I remember that when you know, watching television programs, he would often be the you know, Kodak commercial in between. You can study the evolution of piano in all of its very various forms by listening to Stevie Wonder records. Is that true? I suppose you're not going to get whatever kind of piano Frescobaldi played, so whatever that sort of flavor of harpsichord was. And piano forte itself doesn't show up on any records I'm aware of. But I guess when you start with the modern piano and then go from there, you can hear every kind of 20th century electric instrument happening in his hands. It's kind of awesome. So little Stevie Wonder was born in 1950 in a small town outside of Detroit called Saginaw. He was born premature, and as I think is still the common practice, premature babies are placed into an incubator. And this is the environment in which his blindness occurred. He has retinopathy of prematurity. It's an affliction that stems from too much oxygen being pumped into the incubator while he was, waiting to be able to be strong enough to move out of the incubator. I recall this being something of a common thing in the 1970s. I knew quite a few blind kids in my neighborhood, and they all had basically had this happen. So there's some kind of transformation in technology that occurred between when he was born in 1950 and when I was born in 1971 that eventually made this not so much a thing. But it's interesting to think about what he saw, because he did see. There was a period of time before the oxygen took effect that he did see. But as you, I'm sure, know, infants, while the mechanics of sight are present, cognition takes time. So seeing without context is not the same thing as what we experience, in life. Nevertheless, the mechanics were there. And I think it's kind of fascinating to imagine what that's meant to him and how it's transformed his way of experiencing the world. Here's a map. So here's Detroit. It's in Michigan, which is kind of in the center of the United States. And here's Saginaw. It's a couple hours drive. Around the age of 8, his family moved from Saginaw to Detroit. And they moved to a housing project called the Brewster Douglas Housing Project. This is where really Motown people lived there. This is a picture of Brewster Douglas with the Supremes standing in front of it. So Smokey Robinson was living there. Lots of people were living there. As a kid in the 1950s, he loved church. He actually had visions of becoming a minister. He loved school. He liked science and history. And there's a story about him having a falling out with the church, which is either that he decided to leave because he wanted to pursue his love of R&B, or one of the deacons in the church caught him playing the blues with his friend, like outside on the street corner, and had him thrown out. Here's his church. I'm sorry that I don't have a more glamorous photograph of it, but it's that particular part of the U.S. suffered a really massive economic blow over the past 20 years or so. So here's his mom and his brothers and sister back home. His mother, Lula Hardaway Judkins, she's his rock. She makes everything possible. He attended the Fitzgerald School for the Blind, and his friend John Glover, this is the person he was playing with when he got maybe thrown out of church, was related to one of the miracles. Eventually, his mother was able to move them into their own home. And unfortunately, that's a vacant lot right now, so I don't have a photograph of it. In 1961, he got an audition with Berry Gordy at Motown. And his mom said no. And I don't know if this ever happened to you, but whether as people or maybe parents or relatives of other people who have strong personalities. But Stevie's reaction when he was not awarded this contract, because his mother said no, was to go into his bedroom where there was a drum set and basically play the drums for the next 3 days. And so, you know, eventually mom was like, all right, I see what we're doing here. And she signed him. There are a lot of different stipulations about how much money and a salary for his mother to be able to pay for various things like his outfits and stuff. But here's a little Stevie Wonder. He did not come up with the name Stevie Wonder. His name is Steveland Morris. He's the boy wonder. So what you find in looking at the early history is that lots of people take credit for the little part and lots of people take credit for the wonder part. Obviously the wonder part stayed, but he never liked the little part and he got rid of that pretty quickly. Remember that in the 1960s, the common practice was to release singles first. And then once a certain number of singles happened, to compile them onto an LP. That was definitely the case among many Motown albums. However, and this is his first number one hit. Imagine being 12 with a number one hit. That's what was happening there. But he did actually produce quite a lot of records in the 1960s. So here's his output for the 1960s. The first album, The Jazz Soul of Little Stevie, didn't really make many waves. It's interesting to note that the number one hit, Fingertips Part Two, this is a live version that was the hit. The studio version on The Jazz Soul of Little Stevie has a drummer by the name of Marvin Gaye. That's cool, right? To think of this great vocalist as actually the drummer on one of the first singles by Stevie. Tribute to Uncle Ray. This album is a marketing tool trying to connect Stevie Wonder to Ray Charles, but they're not actually related. And then the third album, the Little Stevie Wonder Live album, that's where this huge hit comes from. But then from the age of 12 to something in the neighborhood of 16, he really struggled. The first record after his number one hit pretty much did nothing. Stevie at the Beach, that's an album. I think it's safe to say if there's one album he wished was not in his catalog, it's this album, Stevie at the Beach. But there's some great footage of him singing Castle in the Sand, which is one of the singles from there. Great footage of him singing that for a live studio audience of really cool teenagers who are all clapping on the wrong beat. Eventually, they were going to just drop him. And that's cool to think about, that there was a point in time when Motown was thinking like, thanks anyway. He got a new A&R person, a new collaborator by the name of Sylvia Moy, and she helped work on Uptight with him. And from then on, we're good, because we have hits on Uptight, hits on Down to Earth. I Was Made to Love Her, of course, is great. The Stevie Wonder Christmas album is my favorite Christmas album. This record, it may be difficult to see on screen, but it says Yvette's Red Now, which is Wonder Stevie written backwards. And it's an instrumental record, has a great version of a Bacharach tune called Alfie. He plays drums and keyboard and harmonica on there, but no singing because his voice was changing. My Sharia Moore, of course, you know, For Once in My Life, I'm sure you know. You might know that that was originally a hit by somebody from the American Standard Songbook universe. It was originally a Tony Bennett hit song. I love both of these live albums because they're both with big band. And to hear him in front of a big band is really different than all the things that we're familiar with. So Stevie Wonder Live and Live at the Talk of the Town are fascinating records to listen to. They also presented a bit of a marketing problem because Motown still wasn't sure what to do with this guy. So he was being sold kind of as like the middle of the road, super commercial, you know, always dressed in the Motown uniform kind of cat. Finally, at the age of 18, he produced Signed, Sealed, and Delivered, and that's it. So from then on, we get the Stevie Wonder that we probably spend more time thinking about. Also in the 1960s, he toured a lot and had a partially sighted tutor by the name of Ted Hull. He was charged with helping Stevie sort of navigate the world of touring while at the same time working on high school studies. The assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. in 1968 was one of those like pivotal moments for Stevie. And you can begin to see the subject matter of his writing change around this time to being more related to the cultural issues of the United States. And in 1982, Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday was voted by our Congress into becoming a national holiday. That process, that would never have happened if it weren't for Stevie. Stevie actually was at the forefront of making this celebration of his life a part of our calendar. So here's little Stevie Wonder. And here he is. That's that same Castles in the Sand footage where he's playing with cool teenagers clapping on the wrong beat. And famous boxer Muhammad Ali. It's kind of cool that he knocked him out. Here's Miles Davis, one of my favorites for sure. And here he is with Sarita Wright. 1970, he got married for the first time to Sarita Wright. Her voice is unbelievably beautiful. One of my very favorite songs of Stevie's is called Come Back as a Flower. It's from a record called Journey Through the Secret Life of Plants, and that's a feature for her. Unfortunately, their marriage didn't last very long because Talking Book is 1972. That's when superstition hits. So 70 to 72, he's really on the road most of the time and putting out records and things. So it was a difficult environment to cultivate a marriage. 70 to 82 is the time period that generally we speak of as the kind of like classic Stevie period. So I'm sure you know tons of songs from this record, or from these records. He's became very interested in synthesizers. And so a thing called the Original New Timbral Orchestra was a collection of synthesizers that he used to do a few tracks on Music of My Mind, but really Talking Book through fulfilling his first finale. That very warm analog synth sound is the result of this environment. So this is the Original New Timbral Orchestra, AKA Tonto. I use Logic, and I'm delighted that when I want to have a Mellotron and a Rhodes work together nicely, I just open two new tracks and it's cool. But back in the early 1970s, that was not how it worked. There was battle between the instruments. They didn't like to play nicely together. And so what these two guys, Malcolm Cecil and Robert Margalef, did was they found a way to be able to get these two things to work together. And the output was, Music of My Mind, Talking Book, Inner Visions, Fulfilling His First Finale. And then by the time we get to Songs in the Key of Life, he's switched to another amazing thing, the first polyphonic synthesizer, the Yamaha Dream Machine. So 72 is huge. He wins a bunch of awards for all kinds of great things that came out on Talking Book and Inner Visions. But we almost lost him 3 days after Inner Visions was released. This is a car that he was riding in that had a tree fall on it. And if you know the album Songs of the Key of Life, you might know a song called Contusion. Contusion is the bruising of a brain, and that's what happened here. He was in a coma for about a week, and everything ended up obviously being okay. But even now, when you look at pictures of him, you can see scarring on his head and face. 1975, he basically won all of the awards for fulfilling his first finale. So many awards that in 1975, that was 74, 1975, when Paul Simon won the Grammy for Album of the Year, he thanked Stevie Wonder for not releasing an album that year. Songs of the Key of Life came out in 76. That's, of course, one of the classics. And from then on, we get Journey Through the Secret Life of Plants. I love Send One Your Love. That's that album. That song from that album, I think, is dissertation worthy. So if anybody's going to get a PhD or something in music theory, that's a song to check out. Hotter Than July kind of puts the bookend on that time period. The 80s is the time period that's the most contentious. I've noticed that people my age and older tend to just write off this period entirely. And in fact, Fausto said yesterday in the interview that they don't play anything from this time period. And we went through a list of tunes and he's like, yeah, we don't play any of those songs live ever. Overjoyed being the only exception. But I think there's a lot of amazing music during this time period. And I think a lot of times what the real issue is the sonic barrier to entry. With the amount of analog that was happening in the previous records and its intrinsic warmth, the new digital of the early mid 1980s has a kind of brittleness to it that makes it a little less forgiving. One of the most vilified tunes during this time period is I Just Called to Say I Love You. And what I found is that when I ask my friends who don't like that song to go check out the version from his Kennedy Center Award when Herbie Hancock was playing piano and a great jazz singer named Diane Schuer was singing. You see, hear the sound of humans. And when you hear the sound of humans, this piece of music that seems so much more trite in its brittleness on the record turns into something really different. But they're great tunes on from this whole time period. Since, let's see, he did We Are the World. He's a busy guy in the 1980s. I'm just kind of going through here so we can get to some music. 2009, a thing to look for is called Sketches of a Life. You can find it on YouTube, and it's a chamber orchestra piece he wrote for chamber orchestra and two pianos. He began writing this somewhere in the mid-1970s and eventually was commissioned to finish it by the Gershwin Prize. It was the Library of Congress. I don't remember the exact prize that he won as a result of it, but it's great to hear him working out orchestration and what would happen if Stevie Wonder was writing for violin or something. It sounds awesome. So that's just sort of like a sprint through his career. We look at tons of tunes. The theory that we use is, you know, Berklee core harmony theory. I do reach out and touch a few other things like axis theory as it pertains to Bartok, not the axis theory that Jacob Collier talks about, that translates into our language as subdominant minor modal interchange, and transformational theory from the Neo-Riemannian transformations. We do deal with that just a little tiny bit in this class. We're going to deal with it more in the harmonic concepts of the 70s. And another one that I'm working on that hopefully will never be like the McLaughlin theory, but we're calling it transformational hearing, is the observation that sometimes with Stevie Wonder's music, you start the verse thinking one thing about the key you're in, only to find out at the end of the verse that you are in a different key the whole time. Then when you take the repeat to go back and hear those same chords again, you have a different relationship to that harmonic landscape. Also, the lyrics usually change from I to you, or from, you know, questions to answers when you get to the second verse. So I'm going to just throw a bunch of silly looking things at you right now, like a pie chart of keys. He plays in all the keys except for D for some reason. It's possible in modulation because I haven't actually mapped the modulations yet. Most of the time, it's some kind of E flat. There's a space where E flat major and E flat 7 as a dominant 1-7 sharp 9 kind of sound where they meet, where it's more like an E flat ish kind of key signature, but basically all of his funk tunes are in the key of E flat. Here's another silly thing, nothing like a bar graph, right? So this is really just trying to show that there are a lot of things in his playing that we can predict, that for example, 4-3 suspensions don't happen very often, but sus chords definitely happen. They usually show up as hybrids. Hybrids like play a B flat chord with a C in the bass. Stepwise motion, you can make an argument that that's just the sound of tonal music. But then when you go and you listen to songs like Ribbon in the Sky and take out the stepwise motion, the character of the song is completely different. So I think just to move by step is an essential part of his language. A lot of times he'll play two chord vamps, lots of pedal points, lots of line cliches, both ascending and descending. There's another thing related to that that happens a lot in his writing that we call a chord connection line, where like a descending line cliche, you're going from one pretty note to another, but it's not always the third, not always the seventh. I don't know, it could be like the ninth, as long as it's pretty on top. That's the main thing. He loves constant structure and he modulates a lot. There are certain modal interchange chords that he really likes. The, you know, 4 minor, there's a song called Lately, which is about assuming or hoping that it's not true that your partner is cheating on you. And when he plays the 4 chord, he says, I'm a man of many wishes. So it has this feeling of floating and elevation and aspiration. And then he says 4 minor, I hope my premonition misses. I hope I'm wrong and she's not cheating on me. He uses 4 minor in that context quite a lot, and flat 7-7 quite a bit. Hybrids, these are those kinds of sus chords. You can pretty much promise or guarantee that the 5 chord is going to be some kind of fancy chord. When he modulates, I think it's interesting to think about where. So there are songs like Golden Lady where he modulates at the end and he's just repeating Golden Lady, I'd like to go there, Golden Lady, like the tag of the chorus. That's arranging modulation. And in that context, it's basically a direct modulation or a dominant modulation. But compositionally, he uses all four of the styles that we work on in the harmony department. So direct and dominant, also pivot, where something is shared, and then transitional, which is where you kind of like destroy your tonal center. Many of the motives are based on pentatonic scales, but his motivic development is fantastic. Part of the reason that we like him so much is we can understand what he's saying melodically. There's always something to hold on to, and that's the result of his great motivic development. Tensions in the melody, that's the bottom thing here. I should just say that it's wonderful to know, wonderful to hear flat 13 in the melody or major 7 in the melody. It's a great sound that is, I wish would stay in the palate more. So yeah, that's enough of that. One last thing here. Storytelling is a really important part of this whole thing. So how you create beginning, middle, and end and build to something has a term in classical composition called proportional architecture. So you can imagine, just like in a literature class, looking at how things build. He's very careful about where the song climaxes. So oftentimes it's even proportional in the sense of the golden ratio. So if you do the math and find like 62% of the way through the song, you'll often find that's the first modulation, or that's some kind of pivotal thing in the story itself. In Living for the City, the album version, in the middle, there's this whole thing where a guy gets arrested and sirens happen at the golden section or the golden ratio moment. Golden Lady, it's not actually a golden ratio song, but the first modulation is actually here. So I think that's about it for this invigorating PowerPoint. I wanted to share some music with you. We've got about 20 minutes and I see that the chat was blowing up. Are there questions here I should try to talk to? Cool. All right.
I think we're good now. We can, as folks have questions, as Rick keeps going, feel free to drop your questions in the chat. And then obviously when you're ready, Rick, we can kind of open up the gates and let people bombard you.
Well, you know, in a situation like this, I've come bearing 70 songs, and that's too much for a situation like this. And so what I think I'd like to do is I'll just play Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Too High. I'm going to play Too High from Inner Visions. And great, I'm glad to see that makes a lot of people happy. We'll play it and check out this chart and just sort of, I'd like to know what you notice. Maybe there are some things that you discover here that I never thought about before. That's possible. But in the meantime, maybe kind of walk through some of the things that we hear in his music that happens over and over. So here we go to back to that. And see, I brought Summersoft also. That's a great one. Okay, y'all see Too High? Yes? Okay, cool. And this, by the way, is not a Stevie Wonder record. It's an amazing Peter Erskine record that you should listen to. Inner Visions to me is, I mean, I know I'm coming at this from a totally biased point of view, but this to me is the greatest record ever. I think that we should definitely be talking about a continuum of the highest levels of brilliance in music that has things like St. Matthew's Passion in it. And things like, I love Mozart's Requiem. I'm sorry, I know that like that's actually not very in favor these days, but I think it's amazing. Beethoven 9, Mahler 5, Kind of Blue, Black, Brown, and Beige, Sgt. Pepper, Love Supreme, Inner Visions. I mean, it belongs in that space. It's unbelievable. So here's Too High. You can see that the volume is mostly all the way up, so careful with your ears. Here we go.
I'm too high, She's a girl in a dream. She sees a four-eyed cartoon monster on the TV screen. She takes another puff and says it's a crazy scene. That red is green. She's a tangerine.
Okay, so usually I fade out. Sorry. So that's basically the entire composition. And that's a cool thing about this course and an investigation in his writing generally, is that very often the music is intro, verse, chorus, or some kind of variation on a simple binary form. You can get through a lot of stuff in this harmonic concepts of the 1970s course that I was talking about earlier. You know, when we're dealing with prog, we're dealing with 40-minute songs. So you can't get through as much stuff. So I don't know. What do you think about this tune? Like, I saw a few people acting as though this was your favorite song. What do you notice in it? What do you like about it? What's mystifying? What's fantastic? It's okay to unmute and talk to me. I don't know if that's like against the rules or something, or I don't know if they can.
So everybody can jump in. Feel free to unmute or raise your hand. You know, you can unmute. It's easier if you want to jump in and share your thoughts. We got a comment here from Yasmin, who's saying that, you know, she thinks that, you know, Stevie tends to prolong his endings, you know, and is that your sort of sense as you're kind of going through the catalog?
Yeah, there's definitely a bit of that. The whole like vamp and fade thing, part of that is the trendiness. You hear that just throughout the mid-70s and throughout much of the 1980s. Oftentimes when vamp and fade is happening, it's also being supported by direct dominant chord modulation up a half step. So again, in songs like Golden Lady, you'll hear it's key of E flat is what it's in. Then you hear him cycle through the chorus, dominant chord up to the key of E, cycle through, dominant chord up to F, cycle through, and so on and so forth, and eventually fade out. The opposite of that is an interesting thing to check out too. Producers like Marcus Miller and who did he work with on Luther Vandross Records? Maybe it was Luther. They often have unbelievably long intros. And so there are a few tunes, particularly in the early 1980s, that are like that with Stevie also, really long intros. I don't know if I can say, if I try to do the jaded thing where I'm thinking about like single length or anything like that, I don't know if I can say necessarily that this is the result of a commercial decision, because he seems to really bring the commercial listeners to him more than trying to design his music to be heard by them. That changes a little bit in the 80s, but in the 70s, I don't think that's so much the case. Cool. Rick, go ahead. Isar.
So, I mean, that whole, the constant structure.
Yeah.
Sound, you know, it could, if you can just, I'm sure it could be a long answer, but if you can shorten it. I mean, where does this influence come from? All this constant structure. There's so much of it here.
Well, let's focus on one of them first. So the answer to the question, the answer to his first question is no, I am not capable of giving a short answer.
Okay, so I risk my, I'm not gonna ask any more questions.
No, it's cool. So, you know, he likes Rachmaninoff and he likes Chopin. He likes Impressionism, but he also likes Russian nationalist composers. And you find a lot of that kind of late 19th century patternistic writing in his hands a lot. So I'm gonna say from a conjecture point of view, it's coming from music he loves from the turn of the 20th century. But more interesting than that to me is the question of what is the constant structure. In this particular case, it's whole tone. And that is cool. That's a thing where you wouldn't necessarily expect that somebody's constant structure is going to be built on a whole tone scale. So here we have a dominant pedal. So our analysis for this is D for dominant, Y. Maybe move it up a little bit. There we go. Not that great. So here's the bad handwriting. So dominant pedal throughout this whole thing. But what's sitting on top of it, if you follow the roots of the upper structure, G flat or F sharp to E to D to C to B flat, that whole thing is whole tone descending with a Lydian color for the chord itself. that I can't say, I can't point to, you know, this came from, you know, something by, you know, Khachaturian or like Shostakovich or something like that. I can't do that. But when I then zoom out and I say, well, Send When Your Love is built on whole tone, and the very beginning of, I don't know if you can hear Rhodes. Okay. At the very beginning of You Are the Sunshine of My Life has whole tone. That move, by the way, this one is an album earlier. He plays it as a consequent, as a response to a call on Music of My Mind. I love every little thing about you. I think that's the track it's on. So whole tone is really fascinating to him and begins to show up in his writing as early as 1971, 1972, and it stays even in the last record he did. There are two new tracks that he dropped on October 13th. I haven't transcribed those yet, but in terms of like up to 2004, you still hear whole tone showing up. You also hear pedal point in his music throughout. So we've got a dominant pedal here. He plays tonic pedals a lot. There are a couple of cases where he plays a subdominant pedal focusing on the two. That's much more rare. The other type of consonant structure that's here is, I think, based on big band writing. And the term for it is planing. So if you think about how, you know, if my melody here on this this E pedal, right? So that's my melody. If I just shadow that voicing in second inversion, then I've got a process of planing that it's like writing for a horn section. It's also interesting that at the end, the final voicing, so remember that this whole thing is over E. I wonder why this is not working out so well, is over E. Here's a B flat chord. So at the very end, it ends on a B flat over E voicing. I'm sorry that Dylan will tell you my handwriting is terrible, but it's much better than what you've seen here so far today. So I don't know what's the issue with my little gear. Worked an hour ago. So here we have a B flat triad with E in the bass. And that's a very typical pianist altered voicing, or, you know, your guitar player plays the B flat over E. Cool. What else about this tune? Anything else you find interesting? Do you guys know the word prosody? That maybe sounds familiar to some songwriters. Prosody is the process of unification. So if you have your melody and your lyric and your groove and your chord and your all these things kind of working together to support a narrative, it's the term for it is prosody. I've been working on a different term, which if you take prosody and everything's unified, I've been working on consity. And this is problematic in my field, because when you start to challenge terms that go back to Aristotle, you really have to be prepared for a lot of people to come after you. But there actually are a number of cases in Stevie Wonder's music, like Village Ghetto Land, for example, where he's engaging in the friction between the musical setting and the lyric. So that I think is a fascinating thing to watch. It reminds me of Hitchcock movies, where oftentimes the dialogue and the setting, and they're different. In this tune, this is actually an anti-drug song. The she character does die in the third verse. But here, the whole song is in A minor. This is interesting, because if this is one, gosh, if that's one, here we have two modal interchange chords coming from parallel major. So it's 3 and 6 in parallel major. And if you look at the lyrics, four-eyed cartoon monster on the TV screen, she's in the process of hallucinating. So you've got this minor sound that's being decorated by a major key modal interchange. It's amazing. That to me is an incredible example of prosody. Let me just drop in on that and play just a bit of this. Check that out.
She's a girl in a dream.
Here we go.
She sees a four-eyed cartoon monster on the TV screen. She takes another puff and says it's a crazy scene.
So that's pretty cool, right? To use modal interchange to support the lyric like that. Yeah. So, yeah, that's good stuff on this tune. Anything you want to talk about, or do we want to try another, try a different song?
Let's do another one.
Okay. Okay. So how about a really deep cut? How about Girl Blue? This is really, just to go back to Ishar's question about constant structure, here's a song that begins with it. If I play for you the 80s song that it reminds me of, you'll never be able to unhear it. But so I'll play the song first, and at the end, if anybody can tell me what 80s song it reminds me of, you in like Gold Stars or something. Here's Girl Blue. Comes from Music of My Mind, which is a very, very underrated record. It's, I think, you know, really interesting to listen to. Superwoman was a pretty big hit, and is one of those tunes a lot of people have covered. The Donny Hathaway live version in particular is amazing. I Love Every Little Thing About You. That's the one where that whole tone thing happens. Happier Than the Morning Sun. Like, what's better than like a really beautiful, happy love song? Here's Girl Blue. Yeah, so there's my mixing and mastering 101 aspect of this. Great fade, right? So did you pick out what song it reminds me of? This is 1972, not the 80s. How about this? Right? So it's just predicting Careless Whisper by Wham. That's a great tune also. So this begins with constant structure. And the cool thing about it is that it has a tonal framework about it. I feel that when he decorated the dominant pedal with whole tone in the last song, the only thing that's really holding us anywhere nearby to do is that E pedal. But here, the general motion of B flat to A flat to G flat to F has a kind of Aeolian descending sound to it. So there's something vaguely tonal about it, even though the pattern itself is really, really strong from here to there, minor chords descending by whole step. In his constant structures, I think I can say unflinchingly that every single time the melody will be parallel also. So whatever the pattern is, there's gonna be kind of like a melodic transposition of that shape each time. So if you look, the first idea starts on 9. Sorry if I play the right thing. the whole thing is transposing down by step. And it creates this environment where B flat is basically do, but then in the second part of the verse, we switch. There's this, we switch to B flat major. And that parallel move is a really great part of his writing too. The use of parallelism. It's not the most common thing, but he does manipulate this pretty strongly where B flat major to B flat minor of the verse, the reverse is happening. And I love this thing where I don't actually hear the one chord as a convincing one chord until the very end of the phrase. So when he pivots us out of minor and into major, the first time you hear the parallel major chord, it's in first inversion. So it's there, but kind of like thin sounding. It's not convincing until the very end of the phrase. There's another thing that's really common in his writing where if you don't know what's happening, just wait till the end of the phrase, because when he actually tells you the name of the song, usually he's going to give you do also. This song is built in an AABA form, which is very unusual for him. The kind of complex binary form you often find in American Standard Songbook tunes is not his most typical thing, but it's kind of cool to hear that in play. And as you would expect in that type of writing, by the beginning of the bridge, if you were in major, it's very common at the beginning of the bridge to modulate to the relative minor, so you can create some darkness and some sadness as a way of modulating usually to the key of five so that you can get back to whatever do originally was, which is very Beethoven-y too, right? You modulate somehow to the key of five so that you can get back to the original key in your recapitulation. So 129, I propose if there's anything you want to talk about, we talk about it. Is that cool, Jason?
Yeah, I think if there's folks that have questions for Rick, or if you just want to talk about Berklee, you know, now's a great time. There's a great question from Isar. Did he work with other lyricists?
Yeah, he actually didn't like his lyric writing until you don't hear him feeling comfortable about it until about Songs of the Key of Life. He is on record saying around the time of Talking Book and Music of the Mind and of My Mind and Inner Visions, he just didn't like it. So very often it's collaborations with his wife in the early 70s, Sarita Wright, sometimes her sister, Yvonne Wright. Throughout the 60s, you see him collaborating with his writing partners, Sylvia Moy and Clarence Paul, but also Sign, Sealed, Delivered, I'm Yours. That lyric came from his mom.
Oh, cool. All right. Yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, is he, you know, a modal guy? Is he using sort of church modes at all? Or
yeah, that's such an awesome question. So to play in Dorian, for example, is unusual, except there's one move he does a lot. He likes 1 minor to 4/7. And so that Dorian 2-chord vamp happens on his first number one hit, Fingertips, but it happens throughout in various like moments for the rest of his career. But then does he write in Lydian? Not really. Aeolian. Aeolian is usually composite minor. So church mode, from the concept of writing within Mixolydian or something, doesn't happen very often in his writing. And I'm going to say, with the exception of Dorian, it's basically never. However, when you take church modes and you apply it to the concept of chord scale theory, what's really interesting is that the theory itself was still kind of evolving when he was a teenager. Yet all of his music has some kind of like, it's always the right tension, you know, like, hey, it's 5 of 6 and look, there's flat 13 in the melody. It's the correct tension. And you know, he'll give us like a 4/3 suspension in that. So you know that it's Mixolydian as well. So there's some kind of connection where church modes turn into chord scales. That's also definitely a part of his composing. Although I would argue that probably the language of chord scale theory is not a theoretical framework that he's developed the terminology for. It's just a part of his writing.
When students are in your class, you know, is it really sort of like an information dump, or how do you engage the students in this Music of Stevie Wonder course?
Well, I don't need to engage them because Stevie Wonder is engaging already. I've had some students who have never heard Stevie Wonder's music before showing up for the first day of class. But by the third day of class, they're like, their minds are blown. They just can't wait to find out more. I try really hard not to make it an information dump because like what we did today is kind of like me just throwing information at you. And I think that over the course of 30 classes, is that right? Yeah, 30 classes, you're going to get tired of listening to my voice and the value of that information begins to diminish. On the other hand, what we actually do is have you make the discoveries. And so when that turns into a discussion about like, here's a thing that I noticed in this song that I think is really cool, then it gives me a chance to support that and say, give it a name. The name for that cool thing is this, whatever it is, which turns into actually great projects. Ultimately, the question is, can you use this information to create music that's built genuinely from your point of view, not trying to sound like Stevie Wonder, but from your point of view as great music? And the answer is like completely yes. I mean, I could play you some projects if you really want to hear them.
Do you have one project you could kind of like pull up really quick just to, you know, the prize project maybe that you have top of your list? It'd be cool to see what your students are doing.
Yeah, this chart, the chart itself is, it needs a little bit of attention, but the writing and the performance is just mind blowing. So yeah, that one is final project. Dylan knows what I'm about to play probably. It's a song called Rain Clouds.
Oh yes. Okay. I remember.
Yeah. This. I played this in Greece.
So this is a student what year at Berklee? Like third year?
She was probably in the fifth or sixth semester. I'm not actually sure if she finished or not. I know that she, so let me share the screen so you actually see who I'm talking about. Her name is Matilda Grott, and she's Swedish, and has been touring with Zara Larsson. So she's got some like really serious commercial gigs happening. You can find her doing a YouTube version of the, doing a live performance of this tune on YouTube. So if you like Google or whatever, Matilda Grott and Rain Clouds, you'll find it's a different performance. I actually like this performance better, because this sounds like a student who's trying to get the work done at 2 a.m. And I like that emotion of that more than I'm making a really polished commercial thing. So, you know, she's got lyrics here. There's some stuff that's not perfect in the chart, but I think you'll hear that it's good music for sure. This is going to be played from my Finder at full blast. So watch your ears. Here we go.
Something broke the spell that held the air. When the morning split the room in half, and you rolled to your side of the bed, the sunlight hurts my head. One more day that you spend in your world next to mine, where I go and miss you all the time, even when you're right here in my arms. I can't hear your heart, the sky ran out of stars. When did your eyes turn into rain clouds? I just can't, no matter how I try, see through your rain clouds. I can't tell what's really on your mind, so say it out. When you smile, even though the gold has turned to gray, even though your mind is miles away, even when you're breathing in my ear, your heart. When did did your eyes turn into rain clouds? I just can't, no matter how I try, see through your rain clouds. I can't tell what's really so say it as it is. Why did those bright eyes turn into rain clouds? I just can't, no matter how I try, see through your rain clouds. Keep raining like this, like this.
Matilda Grott, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, she's amazing. And you know, with great respect for what an incredible, unbelievable musician she is, what I'm finding is that there's a degree of quality that comes from having great material in the first place. And so in a core harmony class where you're just like, hey, show me some secondary dominants, it sounds like a project where you're showing me secondary dominants. But in an environment like this, where we say, like, we just listened to 70 songs, show me something that you're taking away from this to sound like you, but built on great material, then actually I'm getting incredible projects, like, you know, pretty mind-blowing projects, actually.
Yeah, that was stunning. I mean, her total ability to capture the nuance of phrasing, vocal phrasing, the shape of the melody and just the pacing. My God, what a beautiful performance.
Yeah. Yeah, well, check her out, because she's definitely for real. Everything she puts out is interesting. It isn't always as beautiful as this, because there's like a wide variety of things she's capable of doing. But yeah, check her out. So what do you think, Jason?
I think it's been a total joy, as always, Rick, to have you here. We really appreciate your time. And I think we should, you know, take a break. And you know, folks have been online enough, but that was like a huge dose. That was super cool, man.
Great.
Ladies and gentlemen, we really appreciate you all being here. We know that times are tough, but we hope you stay healthy, stay creative, stay connected. Once again, you know, I know people are asking for the charts and the material. We'll figure out a way to get those out to people.
Yeah.
We'll send them to our colleagues, and maybe we can get them on our website as well. But Rick, as always, thank you. We really appreciate all the work that you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Izhar and Mitchell and everybody at Rimon, thank you for the awesome week. We miss you. We will get there soon. We'll, you know, when everybody gets healthy and we can get back on the airplanes, we'll be there as soon as we can. Folks, you know, wishing you the best here as 2020 comes to an end, and we have you know, a really good 2021. All right, but please be well, stay safe, stay connected. You know, follow us online. You know, obviously follow the Rimon School and the professors there. Follow Rick online and stay in contact with him. And hopefully you'll have the chance, maybe when you get to Boston, and you can get into his class. And then follow us on Global Initiatives at Berklee Global, because we're doing more sessions. We've got a few more sessions that we're doing here with our global partners for global connections. And we'll see you at the next one. Okay, everybody. Be well. Take care.